Could I ask Dr. Ramesh to please come up and join me on the stage, please? So we'll cover all the relevant topics in doing the biometry, which is very important to get the post-op results on the dot with more demanding patients, demanding lenses, and demanding outcomes. Biometry becomes quite important. If you get that right, most of your problems are solved in getting the best results out of the more advanced IOLs. So the first talk would be on keratometry, what we measure, what we miss. A very important part of biometry is keratometry, often taken for granted, and that's where the most mistakes occur. We'll have Dr. Jayendran, who will talk to us about keratometry, what we measure and what we miss.
Thank you, sir. A warm good afternoon to everyone. A keratometer, as we all know, is also known as an ophthalmometer. It's a diagnostic equipment that is actually used to measure the curvature of the anterior surface of a cornea, that we all know. So it basically works on the principle of measuring the image that gets reflected from a known object. Here, in our case, it's going to be the cornea. So when we know the image size and the distance between the object and the image, the curvature of the cornea could be calculated using a mathematical calculations. A cornea acts like a convex spherical lens. So as the curvature decreases, the image size will increase, and as the curvature increases, the image size will decrease. So knowing the image size, we can actually calculate the curvature of the cornea. So coming to the procedure, when we are trying to project an image onto the cornea, and if the eye is trying to fix, there could be miniature involuntary eye movements, and that could lead to an image formed by the anterior corneal surface also to move. And this makes the measurement impossible. To overcome this, we have the doubling principle in the keratometers. The doubling principle, we have a biprism which produces two images, and as the eye moves, the image also moves equally. And trying to coincide that is going to be the endpoint for our measurement. So depending on the position of the prisms, as the distance decreases, the doubling increases. Okay, so there are four main parameters that is involved in the keratometer. That is the image size, the Meyer separation, object height, and the doubling device distance. Depending on the object height and the doubling device distance, the keratometers are classified as fixed doubling and variable doubling. The classical Bausch-Lomb and the Topcon instruments that we use comes under the fixed doubling, and the Hackstreet and Javel Shears comes under the variable doubling. Keratometer can also be classified as one position or two position. In a one position, the double images are produced side by side as well as 90 degrees from each other. So at one particular point of focus, you can measure both the meridian. But remember, the machine assumes that the principal meridians are at right angles. If it is going to be irregular, your examination is going to be wrong. In a two position, at one particular focus, you can take only one meridian. You need to rotate the instrument completely to locate the second principal meridian, and that will be very useful when you are going to calculate an irregular astigmatism. Coming to the procedure, switch on your machine, clean the chin rest, clean the forehead rest, ask the patient to sit comfortably, placing the head in the chin rest. The first thing that you need to do is to focus the eyepiece. Set the adjustable eyepiece as far counterclockwise as possible. That relaxes your accommodation. Place a white sheet of paper in front of the instrument's objective lens to retroilluminate the reticle. And now slowly turn the eyepiece clockwise until the reticle is first seen in the sharp focus. And that's going to be the focusing of the eyepiece. If there is an incorrect measurement of this focusing, there could be an error of up to 0.2 millimeter of radius. Now adjust the acanthus marker, adjust the instrument height position to align the acanthus with the acanthus marker. Now these are the things that we'll look forward. The reticle, the reflection of the reticle on the cornea, the horizontal axis wheel, the vertical axis. We are going to deal only with these things now. The first thing that we need to do is put the cross reticle onto the lower right hand circle. When you put it on the right lower hand circle, it says that your optical axis and your visual axis are aligned. The next thing is to make sure these two circles has to overlap. So place the reflection of the Meyers in the center of the pupil. You need to account for three things when you want to measure: the instrument's pivoting, which takes care of the x-axis, the instrument's height adjustment that takes care of the y-axis, and the instrument's focus and headrest tilt control, which takes care of the z-axis. So once the right lower circle is superimposed, now you need to make sure both the plus signs are parallel. Once it is parallel, using your horizontal axis wheel, rotate and make sure your plus signs are matching. Next, use your vertical axis wheel to match the minus signs. So this is a final alignment. At this point, note down the horizontal and the vertical measurements. In case if the plus signs are not parallel, like here, try to rotate the instrument and make sure the plus signs are parallel to each other, then try to overlap the plus and the minus sign. So record both the horizontal and vertical measurement in eighth of a diopter. Record the clarity of the mirrors, say whether it is clear or distorted, that will help you in judging the final outcome. Always record the finding to two decimal point, that is a total of four digits. Right. Any commercially available keratometer comes with a range of measurement for 36 to 52 diopters. In case if you want to increase the range, place a plus 1.25 diopter lens in front of the aperture to extend the range to 61 diopters. Make sure you add a 9 diopter to the reading that you get. Place a minus 1 diopter lens in front of the aperture to extend the range to 30 diopters, and you subtract a 6 to the value that you are getting. Coming to the clinical uses, we all know that it's an objective method for determining the curvature of the cornea, the amount and the direction of the corneal astigmatism, the quality and stability of the corneal refracting surface is a prime important use of a keratometer. Next is the contact lens fitting, a base curve selection in RGP and hydrogel lenses. Over keratometry can detect the contact lens surface irregularities, monitor corneal changes whenever there is a contact lens use. Establish a baseline data. It should be performed on all patients so that if the patient comes in later for a contact lens fit or with a diseased cornea, you know the baseline value. Detection of irregular astigmatism in cases of keratoconus, pterygium, corneal scarring. Refractive estimate in unresponsive patients, especially in children's, amblyopes, aphakic and high ametrope patients, patients with media opacities and a poor quality retinoscopic reflex, difficult refraction, unreliable subjective data. An important thing is to determine the nature of ametropia, whether it is axial or refractive. For an instance, in case if the patient presents with high myopia and if the K reading is going to be just 40, it is an axial ametropia. And the same patient with a high myopia and a 49 diopter K, it could be a refractive ametropia. Post-surgical management of keratoplasty and cataract surgery. There are certain problems which you need to encounter when you are doing it. So first is when you are not able to locate the keratometric mirrors, always make sure the instrument and patient are aligned properly. Second thing is the clarity of the mirrors getting transient. That is, you get a clarity and the clarity goes off. Transiently changes. At this juncture, ask the patient to blink and measure quickly or put a drop of artificial tears. Or if you're not able to do it, ask the patient to come on a different day and repeat your measurement. If the focus is getting transiently changed, ensure the patient's forehead rest is secured against the headrest. The patient keeps moving the headrest, if the forehead, then the focus can change. If there is an unsteady patient gaze, always make sure you close the other eye. If the horizontal and vertical mirrors cannot be measured concurrently, as we said, it could be because of an irregular astigmatism, which doesn't occur with the one position keratometer. Only one minus sign is visible happens when the eyelid is drooping. Only one plus sign is visible can happen when the occluder is on the way. Slightly move the occluder away and then remeasure. There are certain limitations for this keratometers, manual keratometers. The first thing is that it measures the refractive status of a very small central area of the cornea. It actually has a 0.1 annulus of ring of 3 millimeter diameter, which is what the manual keratometers normally measure, and it ignores the peripheral corneal zones. The accuracy is lost when you are measuring a very flat or a very steep cornea. A small corneal irregularities would preclude the use of keratometer because of the irregular astigmatism that it is going to induce. One position keratometers assumes that the patient has got a regular astigmatism. If it is irregular, it is not going to measure. The distance to the focal point is approximated by the distance to the image, which could be erroneous in most of the cases. The most important point is that these keratometers, every individual keratometer assume a corneal index. For example, a Bausch & Lomb uses a corneal index of 1.3375. And this may cause a problem when you are comparing K between different instruments. Corneal and refractive keratometer astigmatism do not coincide for the factor that the patient can have a physiological lenticular astigmatism. There is an effective change of 25% increase in astigmatism going from a corneal plane to the spectacle plane and presence of a posterior corneal curvature. So when you take a keratometric value, you cannot give prescription, that is a subjective value, along with the keratometric values. The common mistakes that happens is inadequate instrument calibration, incorrect examination technique like an unfocused eyepiece, distorted Myers, taking an off-axis measurements, the corneal abnormalities like the irregular contour, inadequate or excess tear film, ointments on the cornea, eyelid interface abnormalities should be overlooked. Inadequate patient fixation or cooperation will definitely have a tough time to do the manual keratometry. Examiner who has got an uncorrected refract error can lead to a fluctuating accommodation that can result in an error risk calculation. A keratometry, always remember that a keratometry should be performed prior to tonometry, pachymetry, biometry or any other applanation testing. Calibrating the equipment on a periodic basis is very important to have a consistent result. You need to validate your measurement whenever you encounter these values. One is that measurement to measurement inconsistency, a very flat or a very steep keratometry, inter-eye difference of more than 1.5 diopters, K1, K2 difference of more than 3 diopters, astigmatism for either eye more than 4 diopters or difficulty in obtaining a measurement. At this juncture, it is always better to ask a second examiner to do the evaluation and then compare the values. Manual, auto, simulated keratometry, as we said, estimate K by different method. So limit your task to a single instrument for all your pre and post-operative measurements. An alternate to the traditional keratometers are the automated machines, which can provide keratometry along with other functions like autorefractors gives you the measure of refraction, corneal topographers maps the anterior corneal surface, optical biometers in along to this gives an anterior chamber depth, wide to wide, the axial length, and it is very useful for IOLPR calculation for the cataract surgery. The advantage of using an autokeratometer is that it allows quicker evaluation. Values are not influenced by the skill of an operator. Inter-eye observer variation could be eliminated. Shorter acquisition time, better patient cooperation, and it's more preferred for children. Despite advances in the technology, a precise and a completely consistent measurement of the central corneal power for all normal eyes could be obtained using a manual keratometry. Thank you.
Thank you, Jayanthan. Can we have any questions from the audience with what he presented? Jayanthan, only one quick question. Which would you prefer, a manual keratometer or one of these auto keratometers or the one that comes optical biometer?
Generally, I take all the three values. Manual keratometers are very good when you are estimating the amount of astigmatism. The absolute K values is much better, especially when you are taking a toric IOLs, it's much better. But for an axis, I rely on the optical or the automated keratometers. So.
Thank you. So we up the ante and go from doing a biometry. Somebody like to look at the topography instead of just doing a K value when you're doing an IOL power calculation. There are many reasons why would you do that. Yeah. And Dr. Nishant Madhivanan will take us through why topography.
Just a minute, sir. A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I thank Dr. Arul sir and AIOS for giving this opportunity. I would like to start and continue by saying that what all Dr. Jayanthan had spoke, and in his end slides you must have seen a set of limitations which he had for keratometry. I would like to say that all what I am going to talk is all the limitations which are there in the keratometry is what we can do with the help of topography. So we know that IOL power calculation in difficult situations, we have a numerous number of data and so many problems with the IOL calculation. But I'm going to highlight on the first three only, which are the most important over here, which I'm going to talk about. We also know that there are a lot of corneal scars which can be either in the central or periphery, which causes these problems. Time. And we know that there are a lot of degenerative conditions such as dystrophies, keratoconus, pterygiums, and all other corneal problems which are causing problem with IOL calculation. We have a lot of post-refractive surgeries from the times of RK to the latest advances in lenticular extraction. And we also have all different types of lamellar procedures which we will have to face with IOL power calculation after they develop cataract. The use of topography is also very useful in toric IOL, because before we know that only the anterior part of the corneal topography, that is the Plessido-based discs, were taken. Then we realized that overcorrection of eyes with the rule astigmatism, and there is a lot of undercorrection of eyes with against the rule astigmatism. So we have to utilize both the anterior and posterior corneal astigmatism with the axial length on the same machine to calculate toric IOL power calculation. So coming over to the first talk of post-RK. So we know that the changes happening both in the anterior and the posterior based on the depth of how much of the RK which is done. You can take an asocity for that guidance as well. And there are three main errors which can cause a hyperopic error in myopic patients. That is the keratometric refractive index, the radius error, and the formula error. And one thing during the surgery also, we know that there can be a lot of mechanical instability. There are chances that these RK marks can open up if the pressures are too high, and that may result in stromal edema with a hyperopic shift once the edema decreases as well. Central flattening happens with some amount of peripheral bulging as well. So the flattest central K on the topo is the most important which we will have to take. And the standard keratometry trends to overestimate the corneal curvature, and we expect a hyperopic shift post-RK patients. So the flattest central K is used for IOL power calculation. So the three factors which I said, one is the refractive index error. That is, any laser vision correction, it alters the anterior curvature, and the posterior curvature is usually unaltered in laser vision correction. So the standard kerometers and topographers measures both the cornea incorrectly. In myopic LASIK, it overestimates the corneal power and underestimation of IOL power in post-hyperopic shift. Controversially, in hyperopic LASIK, you have an overestimation of IOL power causing a myopic shift. So these two things we should always keep it in mind, whether the patient has undergone a hyperopic LASIK or a myopic LASIK. Based on the optical zone and some amount of decentered ablation also can cause changes, because we know that the topography is going to change from the, it takes the 3mm, the 5mm and the 7mm. If there is any decentration, we know that some amount of ablation is going to happen where the topography is going to be taken. And after myopic LASIK, the flatter K leads to an underestimated effective lens position as well, and underestimation of IOL power. Likewise, for hyperopic LASIK, you will have an overestimation of the lens power after because of the change in the effective lens position. Nowadays, we have the online Barrett TrueK formula, which is there available in their website. I use the apacrs.org. It is a very simple website where you have to decide whether the patient has undergone a myopic, a hyperopic, or an RK. And all the changes which will have to write is the K readings. If you have the available data, that is, they have how much they have done for myopic LASIK, how much their K value of the discharge summary, it will be very helpful. But this one website is so useful that even though you don't have all the data which is there present pre-LASIK, you can still get an estimated value of the IOL power post. You get an average. So what about high corneal astigmatism cases like keratoconus and some irregular corneas? So these are, when they have a regular astigmatism, they are ideal for toric IOL. You should just make sure that the keratoconus is not worsening, there is no changes. And also they might be patients where you have masquerades of either PMD or Tyrians as well. Optical biometry and Barrett online toric calculator, I come to a conclusion after doing both together. And in irregular astigmatism, that is keratoconus, post-surgical and other irregular corneas, always make sure that you take the topography. The formulas which consider only axial length and not the keratometry to evaluate the effective lens position usually gives a good predictive outcome of the true IOL power. The K reading which has less of this effect in the Hoffer Q formula, and overestimation is not a factor with Hague's formula, as it does not use the K reading in estimating the lens power. So what about post-keratoplasties, be it keratoplasties or DALK or any other thing where you have suture-related astigmatism? The IOL implantation either can be of two processes. One, it can be beforehand, that is a planned triple procedure where you do a cataract with an intraocular lens implantation based on the IOL calculation done for the other eye. Or the best way is actually to leave the patient aphakic with an intact posterior capsule. Then after you remove the sutures after 6 months or 8 months based upon the surgeon's comfort, then take a K value based on topography and then plan an IOL. That will always be the best way. Because sometimes what we might face situations where the IOL calculation with the sutures will be so good that the patient will be reading very nice and you will be in a fix whether to remove the sutures or not. Because once you start to remove the sutures, the astigmatism is going to change and the patient's vision is going to drop. So optical biometry is actually preferred in these eyes. You can take the biometry from the fellow eye, and central corneal power value inputs are mainly from the tomography. Always use a third and fourth generation formula. Toric IOL can also be preferred to correct high astigmatism. Piggyback lenses, sometimes you place a sulcus, a lens in the bag, it can be an acrylic or silicone. This is the best combination for silicone lenses. And this make sure that that is a single piece lens placed in the bag. And the second lens should be a three piece lens in the sulcus. And regarding the choice of IOL post penetrating keratoplasty or any LASIK, so the IOL with negative spherical aberration would be correct for spherical aberration induced by a myopic LASIK. Refractive multifocal IOLs further reduce the contrast sensitivity and increases the spherical aberration and are not recommended. Diffractive multifocals is not preferred as diffractive rings adds to already multifocal cornea, so it is definitely not recommended. Following RK, always avoid using refractive and diffractive multifocal IOLs. So I always use the rule of twos for the patients who you feel that after implanting the IOL that you are not having the desired outcomes. Wait for 2 months, see two different times whether the patient is having any change in their refraction. And then after two sequence visit where there is no change, you can either plan for a PBGAC lens or a lens exchange. So finally, there is actually a triad of things to be seen. That is the biometry, the topography, which I have the series, and the online calculator. I try to take the value of all three entered together. I try to come to a common value. And definitely depends upon the surgeon's expertise where they decide whether they want to put a in penetrating keratoplasty, whether they're going to put a scleral incision, whether they're going to be clear corneal. In RK marks, mainly make sure that you don't put an incision where the marks is already there. Put it in between the marks, and those kinds of planning, please do it prehand. So that brings the best possible outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Nishant. Any questions from the audience on the topography for biometry? If not, I'll just make one observation. Both the previous speaker and Nishant just made a passing mention about the corneal refractive index being one source of error. Because every keratometer assumes the corneal refractive index to be something. Depending upon which country manufactures that particular keratometer, be it an automated one or a manual one, the corneal refractive index is assumed slightly differently. So when you actually read out the K values in diopters, it is fallacious. The reading is taken in radius of curvature in millimeters. That is converted into diopters using a refractive index. And this is assumed differently in different countries. One. Now it is also assumed differently by each person who's designed the formula. So you're entering it as 45, 47, 48, while that formula is converting it into millimeters and taking it in. Another formula would be taking it in diopters, another one formula will take it in millimeters. It does an internal recalculation. If that recalculation is based on a different refractive index, you're on double whammy. This alone can give you 0.5 to 1 diopter surprise. So what is the take-home message? Your brain is fixed on 45 is normal cornea, 48 is steep, 42 is flat. Keep that in the mind. But what you write down only in millimeters and enter in millimeters. And this is one advantage when my talk comes, while optical biometers are great because they read both and whatever the formula asks, it feeds it in. So you don't have this headache. Am I right?
True, sir. Changes from 1.336 in few machines to 1.36 in other machines. So
and the formula also.
Exactly.
So if the formula is going in the opposite direction, you had it. Yeah. If the formula is going in the same direction, it's fine.
That's where the biometric comes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So if that's kind of understood, we'll go to the next talk. Dr. Sheikh, Atiq Sheikh will talk to us about ultrasound biometer, what we measure and what we miss.
Good afternoon, everyone. Before I begin my talk, can we have a quick hand raise of people who use the ultrasound biometer?
I do.
That's a decent count, because off late, it's becoming like ultrasound biometry is kind of obsolete. It's not advisable to do ultrasound biometry, so a lot of talks going on pro industry, but actually it can be done with certain limitations. I don't have any financial interest in this presentation. To begin with, let's understand how this A-scan works. Well, this works by sending sound waves with the help of piezoelastic crystals. These crystals vibrate and send sound waves into the eye. And when it encounters media of different intensity, part of the sound waves get reflected, part of it goes through. Based on the reflectivity of different structures of the eye, we get spikes. This is how this equipment works. And the ultrasound biometry measures the anatomical length of the eye, or in other words, it measures from the anterior corneal vertex up to the internal limiting membrane. A small drawback of this is the predictability or the accuracy of our ultrasound biometer is about 0.1. However, with an optical biometer, it's about 0.05, or in other words, it's definitely more accurate. And there are two techniques all of us know. One is the contact method, where we directly place the probe on the anesthetized cornea. And an ideal A scan by contact method has 6 spikes. Can I have the pointer, please? Has 6 spikes. The first spike comes from the anterior surface of the cornea. The second spike comes from the anterior surface of the lens. Third, from the posterior surface of the lens. And again, there is no reflection because the vitreous is clear and it's a same media. There is no change. And when it hits the retina, because the reflectivity varies, there's one more spike. Then we have the scleral spike and the orbital shadowing. Most important, all the spikes should be of equal length. Why it is, I'll explain later. And the second technique, or the immersion technique, is slightly more accurate. We use a coupling fluid with the help of a scleral shell. And using this coupling fluid, it can be placed on the eye. The major advantage is there's no inundation, or in other words, inter-user variability is slightly much lesser with the immersion technique than with contact, because compression is kind of eliminated with the immersion A-scan. Because there's a fluid used, there is one more spike which comes from the probe, that is from the fluid interface. The rest all are the same. The same 6 spikes which come with the contact A-scan, in addition to the first spike which comes from the fluid interface. Immersion does have some amount of limitation. Number one, it's quite messy because you use a fluid. And most importantly, if we are using immersion, the shell and the probe has to be soaked in alcohol or hydrogen peroxide for about 5 minutes. We have to wait, then wash it thoroughly with balance salt solution, allow it to dry, and then use. Otherwise, there is some amount of chance for infection. This is something which has to be done. Dr. Jayanthan also emphasized on this fact. All these equipment, generally when we buy, we never calibrate it until and unless we get a surprise. Then we call the company guy and try to find out that there's some mistake happening. Usually, there's a small eyeball-like structure which the company guy gives, which has a fixed axial length value. You can place your probe over it and ensure that you get the correct value. This can be done by us. If there is an error, we can always call the company guy to calibrate it. So when do we get mistakes, or what are the common sources of error? Number one, positioning the patient. This, I feel, is a strict no. Inclined plane, the patient's head resting slightly tilted, is definitely not advisable. The reason being, sound waves go into the eye. Because of the inclination, not all the waves get reflected back. Some of it get reflected in a different direction. Always the probe has to be perpendicular. Only then the sound waves will go into the eye and get reflected back totally. So this is something very important. The patient has to be lying flat. Some of us will have the habit of making the patient sit and do. This again is difficult because it's very difficult to know whether the patient's head is tilted left, right, up, down, or hand, how is it positioned? Are we positioned perfectly perpendicular, or there is a small tilt? So the better way is to make the patient lie down on a flat surface. In that case, we can ensure that all the sound waves go in and most of it gets reflected back into the probe and we get good quality spikes. There's a small fixation light present, but this is kind of difficult because most of our patients find it difficult to look at this fixation light to fix. So alternate, what I do is I tell the patient to hold the thumb. So this, even if there is a hard cataract, by proprioception, even if the light perception is there, they will be able to look at it by proprioception. So this will help us in getting the position properly. And then the probe has to be wetted. Don't use a very thick something like a viscoelastic or a higher density lubricants. Better to use a 0.5% CMC because it's quite thin, almost equivalent to our tears. So the probe has to be wetted. And then holding the probe is something that's very important. This initially is difficult. This again I learned from my mentor, Dr. Arulmozhi Varman sir. You can always hold the wire and do the probe. With practice, we'll be able to do it. The reason being, when you hold the probe directly, there is more chance of inundation. However gentle you try to be, minimal amount of inundation can happen. So this is actually quite practically possible. You can see here, I'm able to do it. I'm resting my hand and then able to do it quite easily. And you can get quite comfortable values. So this was the other thing which I said, when I hold the probe and I'm doing for the same patient, I'm trying to do it gently without causing inundation. And I get two different values with totally different IOL powers. You can see here the ACD is 2.58, the other one is 2.38. It's just a 0.2 mm compression, which is actually not quite big, it's just 0.2. That small compression can cause an IOL power variation of 0.3. Imagine if we had a compression, say about 0.4 or 0.5, the IOL power will be off quite totally. So it's always better to hold the probe. Initially, it has a small learning curve, but with practice, we'll be able to do it with ease. There's something called as gain, which is there in our ultrasound biometers. And simple principle is, when you have a hard cataract, the sound waves are not going in, increase the gain. When you have a very mild cataract, or when you get too much of artifacts from the vitreous cavity, when there's maybe slight amount of vitreous hemorrhage there, always reduce the gain and ensure that you get good quality spikes and not too many artifacts or too many disturbances. This is something which we have to do in case you're doing the A scan on a fakic eye or a pseudo fakic eye when you're planning for a secondary IOL, because the sound velocity changes. All these things are set in the machine. In the older generation machine, we'll have to physically select what velocity sound we'll have to use. So all this is being taken care. Only thing is, you have to enter whether you're doing an fakic eye or a pseudo fakic eye. The reason being, the sound velocity that they've entered is different. The same holds good for the sake of silicon eyes also. The sound velocity, the way the sound travels in silicon oil filled eye is totally different from the way sound waves travel in a vitreous cavity filled eye. And always it is advisable to take serial A scans, at least 4 to 5 A scans, and then take the value. It is not advisable to take 3 different values, say for example 22.0, 22.5 and 23, average out the 3 and then choose the IOL power. That will give totally wrong values. The current generation machines, somehow they take serial about 6 to 7 A scans and they themselves eliminate scans which they feel are inappropriate and select scans which are quite good. In machines which don't have this, you can always look at the spikes, ensure the one with the least amount of compression and the best spike needs to be taken into consideration. Stacking effect is something which again I learned when I was in my training period. This is something very important. Just small mistakes all piled up together, ending up in a bomb. You can see here, there's a small difference in axial length of about 0.1 mm. And then the technician has entered the A scan value differently, 45 and 46, and the A constant is entered differently, 118.7 and 118, as a result of which the IOL power goes off by about 1 diopter. So these are things which should be taken care of, because this equipment, we have to manually enter the data in most of the machines. It's not like the IOL master, you do it and you get 5 to 6 printout with different formulas or different A constant values. You'll have to enter it and ensure that you do it correctly, or after finishing the calculation, ensure that you change the A constant according to the formula that you have used. Sorry, according to the lens that you have used. Biometry in special scenarios. Posterior staphyloma my humble suggestion is, if there is a posterior staphyloma, better do a IOL master or an optical biometry. Not advisable to do all these things with currently. Actually, most of the, some A scans come with an incorporated B scan where actually you'll be able to find out where exactly is the staphyloma and you can do it. But I don't think all this is worth it. This can be done where there's absolutely no access to optical biometry. But currently, when there is access to optical biometry, it's advisable to stay away from all these things. And the second mistake that can happen is in cases where there's a retinal detachment or there is an edema or a tumor. Again, in these cases, because of the elevation, it can result in a shortened axial length measurement. In dense cataracts, sometimes the sound waves don't go in. In that case, you'll have to increase the gain and ensure that you get good values. So the main drawback here is, as I said earlier, this measures from the anterior corneal vertex up to the posterior pole. This doesn't do an accurate optical measurement. Actually, the optical axis is quite different from the anatomical axis. As a result of which, Jack Holliday and Robert Zaldivier, they found that the anatomical axial length is actually slightly more. And the error is much more in myopic eyes or in eyes with the axial length greater than 26. So when you have a high myope or a case where you're suspecting a posterior staphyloma, don't do ultrasound biometry, better do an optical biometry. And the second problem here is, here the measurement is done up to the internal limiting membrane, but actually our photoreceptors are there slightly behind at the level of Bruch's membrane. This value of about 200 microns is averaged out in our current formulas, but again it can vary between 160 to 400, which can give wrong values. So this, again, a subtle change can happen. So with all these, can A-scan give precise results? Yes, it can. This was one case which we did. This was the pre-op vision and this was the post-op vision, pre-op AR and post-op AR. You can give precise and good results provided your technician is trained well, equipment is calibrated. Do not use this in long and short eyes. However, there's a huge cost difference. All of us will not be able to afford our optical biometry. You can use a Lamborghini or a small Ford to travel from the conference hall to the airport. Whichever you'll be able to afford, you can do. Difference is about few lakhs. Thank you. I'd like to invite all of you to our Tamil Nadu State Association conference, which will be happening July 31, August 1st and 2nd at Chennai Trade Center. The submissions are open now. Request you to make your submissions and welcome to Chennai. We'll have a small video presentation at the end of all the talks. Thank you.
Atik, thank you so much. Thanks so much, Atik. Are there any questions for him? This is the most important talk of today, and if you had just followed his rules, we'll be able to get results as good as optical biometry in most of our patients. If you have any questions for him, please do ask him. Can you just have a quick poll? How many of you take the A-scan of the patient sitting, and how many of us make the patient lie down flat and look up? Please put your hands up, those who take the A-scan with the patient sitting. So this is the number one error which 70-80% of us are making, and why we don't get perfect results. If you just make the patient lie down flat and make him look up, fixate the fellow finger, hold it by the wire, you'll be able to get much, much better quality results. This one single step. I call upon Dr. Arulmani Varman to talk about why optical biometry. I didn't know this fact 10 years ago, and I bought my optical biometry quite a few years ago. I wish I'd learned that earlier.
Okay, the question, why should we do optical biometry? No financial interest in this presentation. We all know that ultrasound is where we started, with apprenation, then immersion. If you follow the proper technique, apprenation can be as accurate as immersion. So optical, the first one that came in the market was IOL Master about two decades ago. It really didn't make any difference to the accuracy of the outcome, truly. People bought the IOL Master and they found that nothing really changed. It probably changed by about a quarter diopter, or less than half a diopter. At that time, the error that was acceptable was 1 to 1.5 diopters. Post-operative result was acceptable. So all that IOL Master with all that expense, all it did was about 0.25 to 0.5. Why it did not work and why it's working now. Now, the newer modality is a swept source. So the question is, why optical biometry? Very simply, we can finish off with this slide. It's more accurate. Definitely. And today, with the present technology and the technique, it is just not the optical biometer. It's a bundle of various factors put together. An accuracy of 0.25 diopters is result is absolutely reachable by every one of us. So we thought that biometry meant, optical biometer meant more accurate axial length. No, there's much more to it. So yes, the older formulae looked at only keratometry, axial length, and a lens constant, which was a kind of a derivative of the ELP. We took only these kind of measurements and then we did a calculation. And these calculations of formulae were on the regression formula, where they took a small number of lenses implanted and then they kind of calculated theoretically, not by regression method, where that particular lens would sit in a particular eye. And each eye anatomically is different. You can have an eye that is 24 millimeters long and have an anterior chamber depth of 3.5. You can have another eye that's 24 millimeters long and have an anterior chamber depth of only 2.5. Another variable is have a short eye and a deep chamber. So if you're going to go by regression analysis, unless you've done a completely large number of variable sizes and shapes of the eye, not just the axial length, the keratometry and different axial anterior chamber depth and different lens thicknesses and arrive at one particular formula, which is impossible. So that was one of the reasons why all those formulas failed. And that is why the initial IOL master did not give you any kind of great results. So what did we not do right? We did not look at the proper K. We did not look at the posterior cornea. Astigmatism was not taken into measurement. The AL, of course, axial length was not very accurate. The calculation was based on ELP, on regression for values. No measurement on lens thickness. And effective outcome never went beyond plus or minus one. So we have a stacking effect, small changes, errors in keratometry, small errors in axial length, and the regression formula itself gave you the stacking effect. The newer formulae look at multiple things: anterior curvature, posterior curvature, anterior chamber depth, lens thickness, axial length, and white to white. So what this formulae do, the newer ones, the fourth generation formulae, are mixed formulae. A theoretical formula with regression. So this kind of recreates a structure of the eye and tries to tell you where a lens is going to sit in that particular eye, which is far more accurate, and that's why your results are much better. So I won't go through these. These are all understood. We can skip these, already been covered. So optical biometry is highly accurate, non-invasive, automated method, and axial length, we all know the axial length comes out very, very accurately, good. But is that only thing? Is that only the only point again? In optical biometry, because you're looking at fixation of the patient into the light source, you most probably are getting the calculation or the evaluation right through the fovea. Only if the patient is not going to fixate, it will not go through the fovea. So straight away, your axial length is not only accurate because you're using light instead of sound, you're also getting it in the visual axis perfectly. Of course, limitations were, I wouldn't say they are, they were that in cataracts, especially posterior subcapsular cataracts, dense cataracts, vitreous hemorrhages, these optical biometers were not working. But with the swept source, you'll be surprised. In a totally white cataract, you still get a reading, and the reading is very, very accurate. So then it comes to the keratometry. That's something we'll be talking about. Small errors in keratometry reading can give you large errors in your calculation of the IOL power. So keratometry should be very accurately calculated. Ignoring posterior corneal curvature is another instance for wrong values. So the K values can be determined, as Nishant has already told us, by either the keratometer or by the topographer or by the tomographer. So we'll skip that again. We need tomographers that would give you both anterior corneal curvature and the posterior corneal curvature. The newer swept source biometers, optical biometers, work on the swept source principle. So they also give you the posterior, anterior, axial length, as well as the anterior chamber depth, lens thickness, and the white to white. So seam flux devices, slit imaging devices, and any SSOCT device will give you all these details. So factors affecting the ELP, keratometry, axial length, the white to white. It tells you the shape of the cornea and that way calculates how the lens will sit in that particular eye. Anterior chamber depth and the lens thickness. The IOL related factors are the shape of the lens, the length, flexibility, the angulation of the lens, if any, material haptic, shape and material of the optic, size, whether it is biconvex, plano convex, and of course the refractive index of that particular lens. A given lens, depending on its thickness, if it's a low diopter lens or a high diopter lens, the ELP of that particular lens will change because the nodal point of the lens changes. All of these have to be taken into account to give you an accurate outcome to the result you're looking for. So the newer methods that can tell you are the ASOCT and optical biometers. So coming back to the formulae, this will be highlighted by Dr. Ramesh Dorairajan, but to tell you that we need to go choose the right formula. You need to understand that the most important reading that you will have to take to get accurate results is the first point, is the keratometric reading. Your K value should be perfect. You should have the anterior K as well as posterior K. Then you should have the axial length very accurate. Then you should have the anterior chamber depth and the lens thickness in white to white. And most important is the right formula. If you want to put it in the order of importance, keratometry is most important, formula is next most important, axial length is the least important of the three. I don't mean to say axial length is not important. Of the three, it's the least important. So choose the right formula. It doesn't mean the fifth generation formula are better than the fourth generation. As of today, the fourth generation worked the best. So if you have access, what is the advantage of optical biometer? Why did I put the formula here? I'm talking about optical biometers. The advantage of having one of these is that all these formulae are there available on one platform. On one click, all the entries are there. You can choose the appropriate formula for that particular patient. Hagey Sweet will work for one, and Barrett Universal 2 work for another set of patients. So you have the ability to choose the formula and no transcription errors. Again, playing devil's advocate, all these formulae, or most of them, are available on the net for no cost. You can go on the net, choose the formula, and get the best results. So we come to what addresses all of these. So what is the advantage of the swept source biometer? Not only does it do all these calculations, you can actually physically see the foveal pit. If you don't have a swept source biometer, you have an optical biometer, you're going by the assumption that the patient is properly fixating on the light and the reading is going through the fovea. On a swept source biometer, you can actually see the contour of the fovea, and unless the reading is passing through the fovea, you can disregard the reading. If you have a patient who is not cooperative, you know that the results are not very good. That's one major advantage. Second, all these readings with one click. You don't have to do multiple readings. All the readings that you want come on one click. Third most important is the keratometry. Here, the keratometry taken by the IOL Master 700, again, no financial interest, is the most accurate. It goes by the telecentric keratometry method, where multiple zones are taken, and the distance between the instrument and the cornea is not important. In other words, even if the Myers or decenter, the results are perfect. So that's the most important thing. That's why the telecentric keratometry, as of today, is the most accurate keratometry that you can have. So putting all of this together, what do you have? The best source to get the best results would be a swept source optical biometer of any brand that you choose, because highly reliable, highly repeatable, fast acquisition, very accurate, better measurements of AL in all cases, even dense cataract, and you have newer and better formulae also incorporated. So what do you get again is the accuracy of K value, axial length, white to white, AC depth, lens thickness, no transcription errors, optimized workflow, appropriate formula. And that is why today the optical biometers are probably the best way to go. Again, I'll play devil's advocate. You can work a little harder, spend maybe 5-10 minutes more every patient, and get almost the same results with a simple keratometer, manual keratometer, and ultrasound biometer. Thank you.
Thanks, Arul. Are there any questions for Dr. Arul? Please. Can I ask you a question, Arul? Yes, please.
But how can you guide, I mean, which one is giving this much accuracy, another company is giving this much of accuracy?
Okay, all
your experience.
Okay, all optical biometers are equally accurate for axial length. Swept source, swept source biometer.
Ultimate results wise.
I'm coming to it. So the swept source biometer can read through dense optical opacities.
Thank you.
That's the advantage to go to swept source over a simple optical biometer. Why go for the IOL Master 700? telecentric keratometry is very, very accurate.
Thank you, sir.
That's the advantage. So today, I would use the word today, IOL Master 700 is probably the best. The MOVU the optical biometer swept source is excellent. It's outstanding one. Now you have this all-in-one that's coming in. Swept source units that will do topography, anterior, posterior, axial length, everything put together. And these are the newer ones that you probably look forward to. So the answer would be today, IOL Master 700. I don't know what is tomorrow.
And we don't talk about the price, but everyone is concerned about the price. I mean, this is costing 35 lakh rupees. And how much accuracy we are going to get? Around 0.25 diopter. This is what you are saying. And
from a potential error of 0.75 to 1 diopter plus or minus, you can come down to an error of 0.25.
So that means
if you are going to get within 0.25 plus or minus for every one of your patients, or at least 92% of your patients, it's worth it.
And taking price of other biometers, how much accuracy they are getting? Let's LensStar.
Exactly. LensStar is not a swept source. So it's not going to work in a dense cataract. The K values you get from LensStar are not as good as one you'll get from a swept source.
Sir, they're both the same, sir. The practically, you'll get the same results. Yeah. But if you get mature white cataracts, about 70% or 80%, you can take a reading with a IOL Master 700 and with a TOMI, but not with a LensStar. So we get quite a lot of white cataracts. So I had an IOL Master, one of the old models, for over nearly 10 years. But every month, I used to do at least 7 or 8, or I think weekly 2 or 3
problems.
A scans.
Yeah.
But after getting the IOL Master 700, it's become like one a month. So many of the white cataracts and the mature cataracts, as long as they have one or two water clefts, this is able to image. So it is not necessary, sir. Only if you want, you need to get it. So the cost also, sir. You can get a second-hand IOL Master 300 or 500 for around 6 lakhs. If you talk to the company people, they have used models which are there in the market. So you have a range of costs. You have old refurbished ones costing around 6 to 8 lakhs. And then you have the new ones costing 25 lakhs and above.
Yeah. Another question. How much we can offer to the patient? Like patients are coming, how much accuracy will be there? Actually, if in writing terms, how much we should offer? I, as far as my knowledge goes, and I tell my patients that in 90% of the patients, we get good accuracy. 10% patient, they can have some problems.
So the patient cannot...
To have medical legal aspects and all these things.
Whatever you're doing,
yeah.
If you go and do an audit and you're within 0.5 plus or minus in over 90% of your patients, don't change your technology or your technique. If you do an audit and you find that you're not there, it is over 0.75 in 90% of your patients, no, you're not there, then you have to change your technology and technique and formula. So it all depends where we are.
Now coming to medical legal aspects, patients are, how much we are offering them normally, and that how much accuracy will be there, especially
I would say
multifocals and all these.
You can, with one of these newer instruments and the newer formula and proper application of the formula, you can get to over 95% within 0.25. Definitely. We are there.
Is it written somewhere or it's...
It is not. It is something that is doable, I think.
Sorry?
With...
Sir, the current international standard, if you do all the things correctly, 92% can get within 0.5D.
Yeah.
The very, very good refractive corneal cataract surgeons, they get 95% within 0.5 diopter.
Yeah.
But they take a lot of extra steps. For example, they will not take they will optimize the ocular surface before taking the measurement. They will not just take it when the patient comes.
Yeah.
They will do a tear film evaluation, spend several weeks optimizing the corneal surface. There's a multi-part system which you have to follow, sir.
So many times patients, those who have operated by me or somebody else, they come to the come to you. This doctor, he told me everything will be okay, and now I am having this problem, 0.5, 0.75. How to keeping our colleagues' interest in mind, tell the patient that
this
can happen? This was my question.
Sir, before we take your question, I have also a question for Arul. In a macular hole, Arul, where does the IOL Master 700 focus? At the foveal pit or at a paramacular fixation point.
The IOL master does not focus. Where does the patient focus?
Sure.
That's it. Mm. That's about all.
Super, Arul. Thanks.
The IOL master doesn't focus.
Now we'll come to the last part of the talk. Super,
Arul. Now we come to the, actually what I think is the most important part of the... What formula and why? It's very important. We just blindly have been following formulae because that's what's been given to us. Now you have a whole range of choices. Where would you choose and which formula would you choose? What is applicable today? What is available? And what will be the future? Let's have Ramesh to tell us, looking into these.
So I use SRK2 with good results.
Two.
All those who feel the same, please put your hand up.
SRK2.
Two.
No way, no way.
SRK2 with good results, Arul. No way. Yes. So quite a few of us are here who use SRK2 with good results, isn't it? Why do we need a modern formula? For accuracy, precision, and poetry in biometry, please spend some time looking at Warren Hill's site and look at it every year, because every 6 months to 1 year, he upgrades it and it's worth seeing. Biometry measurements are part of the story. The real McCoy is that you have to have a Rexis that overlaps the optic. If you don't do that, you're going to have results like plus 0.5 this way or that. We all owe a great debt of gratitude to Dr. Graham Barrett for giving us the most astonishing and the best formula free. He's not making money out of it. So 30 years ago, SRK2 was norm. At the time, they had Fyodorov, Binkos, and various formulas. But they found that, if I have a pointer, it'll be nice. They found that as the eye became shorter, 23, 22, 21 axial length became shorter, there was a 1, 2, 3 diopter error in these post-op patients. So what they did was, Sanders, Redcraft, and Trotz together, after seeing only 1,600 eyes, many of us work in hospitals where we do 1,600 eyes in a few months. After seeing the outcome, thank you, Ma, of 1,600 eyes, in the year 1988, they came out with the SRK2, which many of us are still using. And all they did was, they just wanted to push this mean error down, and they said, okay, 20 millimeters, you add plus 3, 22 millimeters, you add plus 1, 21 millimeter, you add 2. So they just made a small change in the formula to push the error down. That's all they did. This is SRK2, which we are still happy with 30 years later. But then we had SRKT, which tried to make it even better, again with a very small number, 1,600 eyes only. When you had SRKT, instead of having a down dip like this, it became slightly better with one small dip here and one small rise there. Now, if you can see, all these are axial length measurement-based errors. We got errors depending on short eye or long eye, and that was a primary criteria which we chose the formula by. But what do we want? We want a super formula, which is straight, flat, plano for all eyes, right? That's what we want. And we know from outcome measures, we cannot get this with SRK2 or T or any other formula. Till about 15 years ago, and I think many of us here, short eye, Hoffer Q, normal eye, SRKT or Holiday 1, and large eye, SRKT. That was a norm, and this was advised by the Royal College of Ophthalmology, England. And this was a norm, I think, for nearly 15 years. Then Haggis came and Holiday 2 came. Because Holiday 2 cost nearly 75,000 rupees, very few of us made the effort of purchasing it. So Haggis was a free online formula. Instead of making a choice of these various formulas and picking short eye and long eye, currently we have the LADA super formula, which tries to do it. It takes a little bit of Hoffer Q, a little bit of Holiday 1, a little bit of Haggis, and depending on the axial length changes and the corneal power changes, it fits various parts of each formula and tries to give you a optimized formula. So he's doing the work which we normally try to, we guess inky pinky punky, and the LADA super formula does it for you. Our attitude about measurements and biometry totally changed with this paper by Jack Holliday and Gillis, where they said, you don't have, all eyes are not the same. Like Dr. Arul said in the previous talk, most of us have a normal eye. 90% of us have patients with normal eyes. So we get pretty good results. But we also do have various combinations, medium, short, and long axial length, and medium, short, and large corneal diameters and K reading. Because we have three types in each, we have 9 combination of eyes. And when you have 9 combination of eyes, all the formulas seem to work for the standard 22, 23, 24 eye. But all the formulas seem to go wrong when you have too short or too longer eye, or too flat or too steep a cornea. So when you have these extreme, a megalocornea with a very large anterior segment but with a short posterior segment, or the reverse, a microcornea with axial myopia, we do see these kind of patients. The standard SRK2 and T cannot handle this. We need to have multiple variable formulas. So even today, the best formulas don't concentrate only on the axial length. They have started concentrating and optimizing for lens thickness. They started optimizing for the corneal curvature, for multiple parameters. For those of us who don't want to go into optical biometry, please follow the Royal College of England standard 2018. This is 2 years old. If your eye is less than 22 millimeters, use Hages or HofaQ. Between 22 and 26, please use SRKT. If it is more than 26, please use Hages or SRKT. Because of transcription errors, they advise Barrett's Universal 2 only if you're having an optical biometer which will do auto transcription, not manual transcription. This is a page from Dr. Warren Hill's site where he describes the different types of formulas, how they work, ray tracing or Virgin's formulas, the artificial intelligence formula of his own, and also in which kind of eyes they work. So the SRK2 and T's, they work only when you have a normal anterior segment. They don't work for extreme anterior segment types. Our idea of the best formula totally changed with this paper, which was co-authored by Jack Holliday, where they had nearly 13,000 patients, all with Alcon IQ, and an additional 5,200 patients with Alcon single piece. He compared several different types of formula, and this is the outcome chart that he got. So he did the surgery, and then he reran the measurements through various formulas, and this is what he got. All the formulas will give an error. There is no formula which gives zero error straight across. And some of the worst formulas see this black and this green here. So HofaQ, if you take it all across, and SRKT, especially for the short eyes, will give extremely wrong readings. Okay, but he also found that lens thickness seems to play a part. If you have a thick lens and a thin lens, different formulas will give different kind of errors. There is no single formula which will give an ideal result for all your patients across different lens thickness. Lens shape matters. If you put a Technis lens, or if you put an Alcon three-piece lens, and you use the best optimized formula and use optical biometry, you will have a varying results. So this is the A constant for a Technis lens for an eye which is very short. You had to choose 121 and not 119. Similarly, as the patient becomes myopic, the A constant will become less and less and come to 118.4 or 5. Again, for extreme axial myopia like 32 or 36, the graph goes up. This U-shaped curve, depending on the lens shape, is true for all lenses. Please believe me, the same lens cannot have a fixed A constant across all axial lens. It actually changes. Barrett tries to work on this. It has 3,000 lines of code, and it tries to adjust for various types of lens shapes, various models, various lens thickness, various corneas. So Barrett today is accepted to be the optimal formula if you want to choose any one formula, and this nobody else but Warren Hill and Jack Holliday, all of them feel if you want to choose any one formula, please go for the online Barrett's current formula. How many of you believe that the Indians, the Chinese, the Japanese and the Caucasians need different lenses when they are measured with the same instrument and you're going to put the same lens? True. So depending on our race, the A constant will change, not only depending on our cornea and the length. See, this is an Alcon toric, and this is the Caucasian eye, and this is the Japanese eye. This is the Indian eye. If you have a Restore implanted in India, and the same Indian goes to California and he has a surgery done, and they use a Caucasian optimized biometric formula in IVOL Master 700, he'll have a plus 0.5 error. There's a difference in the Indian eyes, the Japanese eyes, the Asian eyes and the Caucasian eyes. The ratio of the anterior and posterior segment are different. This is, so all these optimized A constants for different races are present online. They are usually fed into your optical biometers by the technician. Please have a look, because he may put in an old version which is 5 years old. They are getting optimized constantly. My friends, A constants will also change depending on what machine you measure with. Today we have separate optimized A constants for Zeiss, for Hagstreet, Linstar, for Nidec, for Topcon. So as your measurements become more and more precise, and as you start doing a lot, and as throughout the world different surgeons are able to report their outcomes in different numbers of patients, I don't have to depend on my own outcome of 10 or 20 patients. I can actually learn from several hundreds and several thousand patients who have had results from different parts of the world. And you find that the machine makes a difference. Each machine needs its own optimized A constant. And all this is there, and they're changing. So this, to answer the previous gentleman's question, axial length-based formula will give you 80% within 0.5 diopter if you do it very carefully. And most of our patients will be happy with this. If you don't want to buy your BMW and your second or third apartment or a farmhouse, you can buy your optical biometer and your IOL Master 700. Correct, Norun?
Yeah.
With careful optical biometry and current formula, we can get 92% of eyes within 0.5 diopter, and this is for the refractive cataract surgeons. To get the best formula, don't go to your IOL Master 700 or your LensStar. It is not there. They have the older 2-year-old version. You have to go to the version 2, which is available only in APACRS. So only if you go to the Asia Pacific Association of Cataract and Refractive Surgery site, and you choose a Barrett optimized suits from there, the suite of formulas from there, you'll be able to get the current generation of formula. You won't find it in the ASCRS site, you won't find it in your machines offline. This is available online only. And even here, please go for the, don't waste time doing a Barrett Universal 2. Straight away do a Barrett Toric Calculator version 2. And also you can do a Barrett TrueK Toric Calculator version 2 for the post-LASIK eyes. If you do these two formulas only, you'll be able to cover your entire patient load. So the interface is very simple. The printers are very, very simple, and they don't preserve the data. And there are a lot of nuances in that. As you start using it, it becomes easier. And it'll be a rare day when you get a one-diopter surprise. Perhaps it's not that they are perfect. You will still get a one-diopter surprise maybe in 1 in 2,000 patients. It will happen, and it is for us to learn from these patients. Thank you very much.
We'll take any questions for Ramesh. Before the questions come up, I have one for you. I have a potential patient. K1 is 46.75, K2 45.66, so one diopter of anterior curvature. And anterior chamber depth is 3.44, axial length 16.75. So which formula would you use, and what kind of error would be acceptable?
Arul, I know what you're going to do, Arul. You're going to use Hofer-Q. He will use Hofer-Q, and he'll fight with IOCare, and he'll get a lens from them. So in these extreme short eyes, like 16, 18 millimeters, we don't have enough eyes to actually tell where the patient will go. And unless you know the anterior curvature and the posterior curvature of these high-powered lenses, like this patient may need a plus 60 or a 65 lens, right?
Well, Hofer-Q said 54.
54,
and they could not manufacture beyond 52.5. So we put it in, I have a residue of 2.
Okay, Arul. So it also depends on the manufacturer. The manufacturer, if you, in these rare cases, please go back to your manufacturer who does a good lens for you, because he will learn from you and you will learn from him, and he will know what the ELP of those eyes are. It is not possible for us to have one offline or online calculator which can do the work for you. Is that fine, Arul?
Any other questions?
So nobody knows. We don't have enough data to answer a question like that.
Any questions to Dr. Ramesh? If not, we have a lot of time. I think we'll take a minute to play our video for welcoming you to TNOAS Conference 2020, end of July, first 2 days of August. So please welcome to all of you. You can present your paper, send your presentations or your abstracts right now. It's open. The site is open.
Till what date is it open?
Till March 15th. We open till March 15th, isn't it?
Submission, sir. March 8th for IC, sir. March 15th for free paper and videos.
Open that.